I'm really, really delighted to introduce Jiri. Jiri is from the Czech Republic, and I believe it is there today. He's been teaching for 14 years and is a very experienced teacher trainer as well. And he's also one of our presenters for the Learn English with Cambridge YouTube channel. So you probably recognize him. and I'm delighted to introduce you, Jiri. Good morning.
Hello, Dunya. Thank you very much. Such a nice introduction.
Have a fabulous webinar, and I will come back at the end for some questions.
Fabulous. Thank you, Dunya. So hi, everyone. It's fantastic to see so many of you joining us from different countries around the world today. My name is Jiri, and in this webinar, we'll be discussing the question of how to become a proud non-native speaker of English and what being non-native actually feels and means to us individually. We'll be learning ways to boost our learners' confidence when speaking in English, and also we'll learn some practical activities that you can directly implement in your exam classes. If you haven't met me before, I'm a teacher trainer and a video creator and TV presenter, but also, like many of you, I'm also a secondary school teacher and I own my own online teaching business. You can find me on Instagram as Jiri_English. Feel free to add me, ask me any questions if you have about the webinar. Okay, and let's dive into it. Let's ask a question straight. So have a look at this question. What makes you feel confident when communicating in English? Now, if you are a native speaker of English, choose a language that is your second language. So a language that you can speak that is not your first language. I'll give you a moment to think and write me in the chat. So Esther is writing being understood. Idioms, my pronunciation, speaking at ease, intelligibility, if I use advanced vocabulary, or just getting the message across, vocabulary, a lot of vocabulary when I use the right slang. There are so many things that make us feel confident, and we all get slightly different answers. You can see how many things we actually brainstorm in just about a few seconds. Now, if somebody asked me, I'd probably say things like writing a song in English with my band, or joining an exchange program in the Netherlands when I was a teenager, or passing various kinds of exams. Or things that you mentioned as well, feeling safe with someone I'm talking to, or just the sole fact that somebody registers what I say, so being understood. Let me ask another question. What affects negatively your confidence when communicating in English? Again, I'll give you a few moments to think about it, and then please write me in the chat. When somebody corrects my mistakes, constant correction. As a teacher, I had an imposter syndrome, which is also an interesting topic to discuss. Fluency. When I can't recall specific words. Being judged by native speakers. Insecurity of confidence. Accuracy. So I guess lack of accuracy. When I'm judged. Slang, my accent, lack of vocabulary. When I use something wrongly, some wrong collocations. Now, for me, it's really interesting to see that we all give slightly different answers. But at the same time, if you look at our answers, there are already areas and patterns that somehow reappear. Now, I would like you to think about this question now. How often were you asked these two simple questions by your teacher of English or of German or Dutch or whichever language you've been learning? Oksana, never, rarely, actually never, honestly never. I'm waiting for one person to say yes to these. I did the same mental exercise. You know what, guys? I couldn't think of a single teacher who asked me these questions. Most of my teachers tended to tell me what to do or show me how to do it, rather than help me reflect on what worked for me. So probably I subconsciously knew what boosted my confidence, but I never really explicitly addressed it, nor consciously worked on these aspects in or outside the classroom. So that's why I asked my learners, and I asked the learners of my colleagues and my followers, these two simple questions. And I decided to base my webinar on these two questions and on the practical or on the real life experiences of my respondents. There were over 100 respondents. They all answered through Google Form and social media messages. By the way, just asking these two simple questions could be a really nice first activity that you can do with your learners to start and kick off the conversation on confidence when it comes to speaking English. So I think most of us would agree that one of our goals actually is to boost our learners' confidence. So the questions arise, how can we work on confidence more explicitly in the English classroom? And what are some of the practical activities that we can use? To answer these questions, I have created this webinar. And I would like to achieve these two goals with you guys today, to learn about what influences learners' confidence when communicating in English, and to have more ready-made activities and ideas for our lessons in our toolboxes. This webinar is primarily aimed at teachers that prepare their learners for their B2 First for Schools and C1 Advanced Cambridge exams. However, most of the activities that you are about to try out can be adapted to suit higher level students and lower level students' needs. So for example, B1 preliminary students can do the more complex reflective stages of the activities in their first language. Now, what follows is a little bit of a theoretical background for us to discuss and agree on the terms of proud and non-native, and then practical activities that you can implement in your classes. As it is often the case, I will, if possible, I will treat you as my learners for you to get a genuine real-life experience. Okay, so why have I called this webinar How to Become a Proud Non-Native Speaker? If you look in the Cambridge Dictionary and you look up the word proud, these are the definitions that you get. Feeling satisfaction and pleasure because of something that you have achieved, possess, or are part of. And having or showing respect for yourself, which I believe are all qualities we would love to encourage in our students. Now let's move on to the second term. The non-native speaker has been a very loaded word and which has very different connotations for different people. If you look up the word non, in the Cambridge Dictionary, you get definitions like not, or the opposite of, or the absence of. Now, I believe that the way we label people and the way they understand these labels always have real life implications. So the potential issue with the definitions like these is that non-native speakers might get to the negative conclusion that they are something less than native speakers. Some of us might even opt for using alternative terms like a polyglot or a bilingual speaker. What's more, label or these kinds of labels also invites for social comparisons. Have a look at what one of my, quite a few learners actually said. When I'm speaking with a native speaker, I am less confident because I'm aware that my English is obviously worse. Have you ever felt like this? And now, and many people are saying, yeah, yes, some people are saying no, some people used to feel like this. Now, what I very often read and see teachers saying, and I think it's coming from a good place, is don't compare yourself to others. Based on my personal experience and actually based on extensive research that I've read through, it's not always simple actually to switch off the comparison autopilot. As Abraham P. Wang and Frederick X. Gibbons say, the desire to learn about the self through comparison with others is a universal characteristic of humans. So, that is, eventually, we all make social comparisons. The social comparison theory introduced by Lynn Festinger and later adapted by T.A. Wills, identifies three different types of social comparisons. Lateral social comparisons towards people on the same level, upward social comparisons towards people on a higher level, and downward social comparisons towards people on the lower level. Now, the interesting thing about this theory is also that the fact that upwards and both upwards and downwards comparisons can lead to boosting or negatively affecting your confidence based on your current situation and also on your current self-esteem. So it shouldn't have come as a surprise to me that quite a few learners reply to the question of what negatively affects your confidence by saying, when I speak to someone who speaks worse than me. Which is basically a downward social comparison that brings up or that somehow helps their confidence. On the other hand, if you have a social an upward social comparison, it doesn't necessarily have to be accompanied by the feelings of inferiority or jealousy. It can be also, and we probably have experienced it, and this is very important, if you already have a high self-esteem, it can be very stimulating or motivating to see people doing better than you. Now, I'm not saying that we should encourage our students to make social comparisons, but I do believe that we should somehow make ourselves and them aware that comparing is something we all eventually do. And by asking questions like when and why do you compare yourself to others, we can help our learners to make more conscious choices of their behavior, and we can somehow follow up on those findings in our lessons. So just like different comparisons can affect us positively or negatively, so can the reality of being a non-native speaker influence our confidence in a positive or a negative way. I actually really like the definition given by the Cambridge Dictionary, which says, someone who has learned a particle language as a child or adult rather than as a baby. So this webinar aims to help teachers to help their learners to embrace the fact that they have achieved to learn the second language as a child or as a teenager or as an adult, and as such become proud non-native speaker. Okay, great. Let's start with some practical activities. Now, I have somehow, based on all the responses I got, there are certain areas that repeated. So I decided to prepare activities based on these four areas. There are definitely more, and these four were the most prevalent. Always to make my case, I will show you first the comments from the respondents that were positive, that boosted their confidence. They will be marked with a star. And then I'll use the emoji, the thinking emoji, for comments which describes the answers to what negatively affected my confidence. So the first area that we identified was become proud of your accent. So let's have a look at what some of my learners said. My accent and intonation, I speak clearly, which makes me more confident, even though my vocabulary isn't the best. I'm sure you have students like these as well, who really enjoy the way they sound. When others understand me with no problems. My accent. When people during my speech try fixing my accent. Activity one, my accent. As I said, you guys can be my learners now, my students, and you can play these activities with me. So if you want, close your eyes. Imagine the way you sound. How do you feel about your accent in English? Do you enjoy speaking in English? And also, is there anything you like about your accent? Now you can open your eyes. Stage two, here I usually use the free writing activity on the topic. So if you haven't done a free writing activity before, the rules are Write your immediate thoughts on the topic without pausing. Don't edit or cross out words. And don't worry about language mistakes. And your learners write down everything they feel without stopping, without somehow editing their thoughts. And you give them a 5-minute limit. And when they stop, they can share their ideas with their partners. So stage 3, talk to your partner and share with them your ideas on the topic. You can also just tell them this is for you, this is your reflection, and you don't need to share, depending on your goal. Now, I always love to add reflection moments at the end of my activities. So I would ask a reflective question like, why is it useful to reflect on the way we sound? Is there a link between how you sound to how confident you feel? And you can also answer these in the chat box if you want. Usually the answers that I got were, if I am happy, or most of my students said, if I am happy, if I feel happy with my accent, I actually feel way more confident. So this can lead to insightful discussions that can bring up some personal individual goals, pronunciation goals. Okay, activity 2, role models. Stage 1, think of this question. Is having a foreign accent a disadvantage? Now, learners can make a list of advantages and disadvantages of having a foreign accent as well. And everybody's saying, no, absolutely not necessarily, not so much. It can make you comprehensible. I don't think so. Now, for stage 2, I chose text that somehow supports the current view, maybe the current trend. It's taken from the World of Better Learning blog. So I'll give you 1 minute. What is the author's argument, and do you agree? I'll give you 1 minute to read through. Once you finish reading, obviously ask your learners for feedback, for the answers. So one of the answers that you might get from your students is, according to the author, having a foreign accent is no longer a disadvantage, since a large majority of people using English have different first languages. And it correlates to what we have just said, right? Most of us are non-native speakers, or polyglots, or bilingual speakers. Stage 3, I found these 3 pictures. Let's see if I can pronounce the names of these celebrities well. Do you know who's the first celebrity, the first notable person? Well done, Sofia Vergara. I'll pronounce it well. And the second one, Javier Bardem. And the third one, does anyone know the third one? No idea. Okay, Patrick Cech, he used to be one of the best football goalie. He is from the Czech Republic, so my country. So what do these 3 people have in common? A football player, well done, Anna, yes. They all work in English, and they've all been, even though their language, their first language is different to English, they were very successful when using English at work. Okay, stage 4. Can you think of any successful, well-known personalities from your country who use English at work? Now, obviously I'm asking you, so you can start brainstorming in the chat box. You can ask your learners to write these names on the board. You can create a shared Word document so that everybody works at the same time and add these names of notable people. Okay, so good, we've got some some load up, yeah, quite a few notable people in the chat box now. Stage five, now I would choose one of these notable people. I would find a YouTube video with them. So I have this video of Peter Cech. We don't have time for it today, unfortunately, because we have so many things prepared for this webinar, but you would see Peter Cech talking in English and describing what helps a goalie, what kind of mindset a goalie should have to be successful. And you can ask them questions like, how well does Peter Cech communicate in this video? I believe that this activity can stir very interesting discussions about the local accents and about the whole fact of intelligibility, what it is, what is important and what is not important when it comes to your local accent. And some students can be really inspired by local role models speaking in English. However, and also I would reflect on the question like, why can it be useful seeing well-known personalities from your country who speak great English? And I believe that some people, the most obvious answer would be, they have exactly the same starting point like me. So they show me that it's possible to be successful in the world using a different language that is my first. Even though some people might be inspired by their role models from their own country, there are also people who like different accents and they can be also native accents. So I also believe that what Mark Hancock says, some learners simply like a certain accent or feel motivated by a vision of themselves speaking English like a native, and we should respect their wishes in this. So no matter which goals they somehow choose, I think we should support them to achieve those. Okay, now also notice that in Cambridge exams, you are not graded on your accent, which is very important to stress here. Examiners do not expect students to sound like native speakers. Pronunciation is graded based on intelligibility, that is clarity, correct intonation, but not accent. Okay, activity three, let loose. This activity was based on the experiences and comments made by shy students who don't enjoy speaking in class. This is what one of them said. I don't like speaking. I'm not very good at it because I don't talk. And I'm sure you have students like these. Now, I've come up with these three ideas that can help these students improve their pronunciation. One of them is choral drilling, where you all, with the whole class, drill chunks of language. You can try it with me. So we can say, could I start by? Could I start by? Look surprised and say, what's the best way for us? What's the best way for us? Or frown at me and say, are you entitled? Are you entitled? And the great thing about this activity is that your students are invited to repeat. They don't feel so exposed because everybody's saying the same, but also they don't have to say these sentences. They can say them silently. Another idea is playing background music, which I think is a great idea as well, especially for pair work or for group work, so that you don't feel that you're being listened to by the whole class. And also shouting dictation. Have you tried shouting dictation before? So the shouting dictation activity is that you and your partner start standing on the opposite side of the classroom and you shout and dictate text to each other. So you have to pronounce really well. It's a bit of a wild activity, so you can try it out if it works with your class individually, but it works really well with my shy students because they just let loose and it gets a little wild and fun. Okay. Moving on, area two, prove yourself to yourself in real life situations. Achieving something in the real world with your English is an absolutely satisfying and transforming experience. Let's have a look at what some of my learners said. When I help someone in English in public transport, when I tell a joke in English that makes people laugh, when I failed to buy street food because I didn't understand what the fast food worker had said. So how can we provide space for these real life achievements in our exam classes? Activity one, the time I felt proud of my English. If you have any questions, I see that Malika, for example, wrote, is type of music background important? Write them in the question, the Q&A box, and we can discuss that at the end. I would say that it is. what kind of music you choose. I, for example, play music without lyrics. Can you think of a memory when you felt proud of yourself using English? And again, you would ask your learners you would give them time to think about it. For me, it would probably be my first high school exchange program to the Netherlands, where I had to use English to organize everything and to survive with the host family. And stage two would probably be then a mingling activity. So speak to as many people as possible and share your anecdotes. And then we would reflect. Why do you think you remember this situation? In which situations do we feel proud of our English? And I think just giving space to these sorts of questions can somehow create a safe environment in the classroom, and our learners might become more explicit in what they need. Okay, activity two, real world English challenge. Now, when I was a teacher at an elementary school in the second largest city in the Czech Republic called Brno, we organized a fantastic project that absolutely boosted my learners' confidence. They had a week to prepare their own guiding tour around the city. And on Friday, we met up with an actual free walking tour guide, who was my friend, and they gave a tour to actual tourists. They managed really well. And for many of them, it was the first time they had used English outside the classroom. The sense of achievement absolutely boosted their motivation and confidence. So this idea follows a similar path. Stage one, brainstorm ideas for real world English challenges. Maybe something you would love to be able to do in English, but maybe you haven't tried before. So these could be find and speak to a new English speaking friend. Make a hotel booking via phone for your next family holiday. Tell a joke in English. Make a podcast episode about music. Learn and sing a song in English. Stage two, plan your real world English challenge. And I think it's very important that we give time for this planning in our lessons. Also plan what piece of evidence you will bring to class to share the experience with the others. Stage three, action outside the classroom or in class. And our learners record their own podcasts, make their own songs, or they just chat to somebody new online. And then stage four, back in class demonstration, the exhibition of learners' experiences, where they show the results of their work. And also they reflect on the process by asking and answering the questions like, why did you choose this challenge? How did it go? What helped you overcome your challenge? For me, the main aim of this stage is not only to reflect, but also to somehow recognize and celebrate the achievements of our learners, and as such, boost their confidence. Speaking of real life experiences, Cambridge books are fantastic resources for preparing our learners for the real world. So for example, in the Open World course book series, you can find real-world sections in each unit. You can learn new vocabulary, watch videos, and simulate real-life situations in your classes. Area number three, develop a positive attitude towards mistakes. Now, I'm sure this is something we all can relate to. Let's have a look at what some of my students said. When the other person doesn't really care if I make a few grammatical or verbal mistakes. Fear of making mistakes. When someone calls me out for a small mistake. Activity one, my favorite mistake. I'm gonna tell you a short anecdote. When I was a teacher of English at an English camp, at an English camp during the summer, I was sitting in a canteen with one of my American colleagues, and I was telling her, hey, I'm actually leaving tomorrow. And to which she replied, oh no, are you leaving for good? And I just remember myself sitting there, and I couldn't make out what she meant with the word good. What was good? It must have been like 10 or 15 years, 10, 12 years ago. And I still remember this whole situation so vividly. And I remember the mistake I made so well. Now, it's very interesting, these moments, aren't they? And I think we can maybe reflect on these more in our lessons with our students. So stage two, do you remember any situation when you made a mistake in English? And again, our learners discuss with their partners, share their mistakes, and maybe as a follow-up activity, you can collect these mistakes and then practice the corrections of these mistakes regularly in your lessons. Maybe you can create a Quizlet set. And then you reflect. So why do you think we remember situations like these? How useful are mistakes for us? And to answer these questions, I actually found this study, which says the process of making mistakes actually activates a greater network of related knowledge in the brain, which leads to superior learning outcomes. So just twisting this logic of being afraid of mistakes, maybe it's better to start realizing that our brain loves mistakes and our brain rocks when making mistakes. Activity two, where's your focus? So this is based on a comment which I saw in the chat box, and many of my learners have said the same. When people judge how I speak, now, these are the instructions you would give to your learners. Work in pairs. One of you close your eyes and the other one get ready to read instructions from the screen. So one of the partners, their eyes closed. The other one is reading these instructions. Tell your partner about something you enjoyed doing this week. On purpose, make a few mistakes in the past tense. Say, for example, I play tennis with my friends, or yesterday I go there. Now, stage three, the other partner opens their eyes and they discuss, talk about what enjoyed doing this week. And one of them makes a few mistakes in the past tense. Stage four, and this is important that it happens the next day or a few days after, you ask your partners again, do you remember your partner's story? What do you remember about your partner's story? And do you remember any mistakes that they made? Now, to address these questions, I am using here also a segment from my Learn English with Cambridge video on confidence that you can find on the YouTube channel very soon. And I would ask them a question. Do you agree with what Iris says in the video? Let's have a look.
Also notice that your listeners care much more about what you say rather than about your mistakes. For example, when I tell my wife in Spanish about my plan for the weekend, making a few mistakes.
Voy a jugar la guitarra este fin de semana.
Qué bien!
2 days later, she remembers only my plan to play the guitar, not my mistakes.
And it was very, very true for my learners. So most of them agree, but you can have a discussion. Was it the same for you? Did you remember more the story or more the mistakes? And notice that teachers and students often worry a lot about accuracy. But notice that all Cambridge marking criteria for writing and speaking give equal weight to accuracy as it does to communicative achievement, that is getting your message across. This one is for B2 first writing, but the same applies also to B2 first speaking. Just a quick note to say that all marking criteria is available in the handbooks, which are on each exam's preparation pages. And at the end of the activity, once again, you would reflect. So let's reflect. In your experience, to what degree do listeners focus on and remember what speakers' mistakes? do listen and focus on and remember speakers' mistakes. In our, as I said, the experience of my learners and mine was they don't actually care as much as we might tend to believe. So maybe it might answer the question of to what degree we feel judged and to what degree they actually judge us. And the experience of my learners was that they didn't remember the mistakes as much. So a nice experiment maybe to try out in your classes. Okay, finally, you often mentioned as well, there are some more questions there. If you have any more questions, put them in the Q&A. You also mentioned when you feel safe, or many of my learners mentioned that they best perform and they feel confident when they feel safe with the people they speak to. Have a look at some of the comments. Speaking with my people that I trust. Most important is how I feel about the person I am communicating with. When I talk to someone who listens to me, what negatively affects my confidence? When the person I am communicating with looks uninterested in the conversation. When I am unsure about what I'm communicating. Now, I'm sure that many of you have probably heard about the Maslow's hierarchy of human needs and the whole theory behind it. So it basically says that the lower order needs, like safety, need to be fulfilled first before we can even start thinking of and striving for the higher order needs like self-esteem and confidence. We all can need slightly different things to feel safe when speaking in English. So I think it's an important thing to open up discussions about this with our learners in a safe environment. So my last activity is sharing circles. Maybe you have tried it out yourselves as well in your classes. You all sit in a circle with your learners and you place a talking piece in the middle of the circle. It can be an object that you find suitable, it can be a pebble, it can be a ball. And then one of the students picks up the talking piece and you ask them to do the following task. So only the person with the talking piece can speak. Choose and speak about the time when you felt proud, when you felt afraid, when you felt sad, or when you felt happy when communicating in English. And learners give anecdotes and the other ones are listening and practicing active listening. Once one student is finished, they can pass the talking piece on, or you can use the popcorn method. So the popcorn method is when somebody pops and they're ready, they can take the talking piece and they can tell their own anecdotes. And at the end of each round, at the end of each anecdote, rather, all listeners each say one word or phrase that first comes to mind about the story they have just listened to. So this is a perfect activity for them to practice active listening and show or improve, I think, as well, their empathy, trying to put themselves in the shoes of others. And then we would reflect. So what is the purpose of this activity? What helps us feel safe when communicating in English? You can brainstorm ideas with your learners. You can note them down. I think you can also identify things that you can follow up on in the next classes. But just creating space to have these discussions can somehow help your learners to feel more confident in your classes. All right, so these were my four areas. We are coming to the end of my presentation, so let's recap. I have achieved these two goals with you guys today. We have learned about what influences learners' confidence and when communicating in English, and we now hopefully have some very practical activities and our toolboxes, which don't demand much preparation. So like the great thing about these is that there are concepts that you can apply to different material. So that's both ticked. We have identified and discussed and played with activities for these four different areas. So we have become proud of your accent, develop a positive attitude towards mistakes, prove yourself in real life situations, and find ways to feel safe. To conclude, no matter which activities you decide to experiment with and implement in your classes, I believe that we English teachers can help our learners become more aware of what helps them, what improves and boosts their confidence when communicating in English. We can help them work on these respective aspects more explicitly and consciously in and outside the classroom. And also by listening to their experiences, by creating space for them to discuss their needs, we can become their supportive guides and help them to create space where they can celebrate their achievements. And as a result, they can become proud non-native speakers of English. So this is the end of my presentation, guys. Thank you very much for being an amazing crowd. And now I'm ready for any of your questions. If you're interested in anything that I've mentioned in this presentation, I've also added links to respective materials and resources.
Thanks so much, Jiri. It was really such an interesting presentation, and I love the way that you sort of switched the narrative to put it on students and teachers. What makes you feel confident to improve your English, rather than always coming from the teacher deciding what to do? I thought that was a really enlightening way of looking at it. Lots of positive comments and questions coming in. You just mentioned that you have added links to all the resources. So in the post webinar email, we'll include those resources. Okay, so you won't have the slides to the webinar, but you will have lots of links for you to go and look at resources and any further reading around the topic. So again, check your jump box, and that will be sent out next week, okay? So not right after the webinar. Right, lots of questions. Interestingly, lots of questions surrounding pronunciation, because you did touch on that. A few different questions around. Somebody asked, obviously, for students, we can say, pronunciation, accent, isn't the most important thing, but as a teacher, is it more important that you have a more native sounding accent so that you can ensure that your students can get a better accent, or does that not matter?
Right. Like I do believe that, as always, it's about you specifically, and I'm now talking to all of you 642 teachers out there. it's about your individual feeling about it. I honestly think that it is whatever makes you feel most comfortable with how you sound works best. Obviously, there are moments when you pronounce something and other people don't understand, there might be a moment where you think, I might change this, I might change that. So I don't know if I've answered your question. For me, I personally loved the sound of some certain accents, and I somehow grew into it. And I think I found somehow my accent along the way. So
one of the teachers commented in the chat box when you asked the question about accent, and the comment was, having an accent isn't a disadvantage, it's a privilege. And I love that quote, because I thought, yes, of course it's a privilege, and you should be proud of the fact that you've mastered this language, and you're able to speak another language is incredible, and you should wear that with pride, and that includes your accent.
Absolutely. I've just seen another question there. Mm. Sorry, the chat is going so fast. So I don't know. I can't see the name of the person. Sorry, I can't scroll up. But what is the remedy for for students having a native speak and feeling embarrassed, you know? So they were saying like, what can I do when I'm a native speaker and I feel that, you know, I can't change my accent, can I? So I think I have one idea, but I'm not in your position. But what I would maybe try, and it always helps, is trying to learn their own language a bit. So like whenever I had a teacher who was trying to speak to me in Czech, and there are quite a few teachers who tried, it also shows this kind of, you know, whenever we show ourselves a little vulnerable as well, we are just people just like them, it somehow, we start claiming this middle ground, we somehow start being more equal, right?
That's a really interesting point, yeah, showing your vulnerability as a teacher and that you might have struggles learning a language too.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's a really nice way to look at it, yeah. We had some lots of questions when you mentioned background music. So I know you addressed it, but then we've had more saying, but what sort of music? you said you prefer music without lyrics. Is that
I usually do. Yeah, I know we talked about it the other day, don't you, right? That you use music as well. What kind of music do you use?
Oof. Well, it depends. It would depend on sort of the age of the students and the levels. I often found, a bit like you, if I had young learners, for example, and I ever played music with lyrics that they knew, it meant that they stopped concentrating and they started singing along to the song, which isn't the point of the activity. The point is it's background music to make the environment a bit more relaxed and not so quiet, to encourage them to talk. So I think your point about not having lyrics is a good one, because you don't want the focus to be on the song, you just want it to be in the background.
So specifically, maybe not using a song with your own first language, right? Like that's probably what we
be. Yeah, or just something that you maybe think that they don't know, that's not really popular. Something that can be in the background and help them relax. And
so I've used,
and the volume as well depends, because you can start off a bit louder and then you can turn the volume down a bit as you can see they're getting more comfortable and start talking more, because you also want to be able to listen to them to be able to hear what they're saying.
Absolutely. It can also work like a time limit factor, so you can say speak until this song finishes, and usually you can feel it fading in, you can feel it, the activity so there doesn't have to be this abrupt, hey, stop and let's do something else. So there can be a nice transition between activities.
That's a really good idea, yeah. And then there was a question about building confidence and accuracy, and how much to correct students. And the question actually said, should non-native teachers correct grammar mistakes during speaking activities? But I don't think it makes a difference in that question, whether it's a non-native speaker or a native speaker. Really, it's how much should we correct grammar mistakes during speaking activities in class?
Right. That's such an interesting discussion to have. I think it's a never-ending discussion, isn't it? Error correction comes and goes. It's like eventually we all discuss it here and there. What I started doing is that I actually correct the accuracy when speaking. I correct way more of my higher level students rather than lower level. So I focus way more on fluency with lower level students. And give, obviously we have moments where we practice like these, you know, chunks of language and like grammar points more in a more controlled way. But it really depends on what your goal aim is, right, of the activity.
And I suppose as well, coming back to the point you made earlier in the presentation, is if we're focusing on higher levels or older students, it's putting it on them, like what do they feel comfortable with, what do they prefer? Because I used to find some students would say, I want to be corrected constantly, but some you don't want to correct them constantly because you don't want to dent their confidence. You want them to speak and get all of their ideas out and then come back to it after. So it's sort of not a one size fits all, is it? It's really up to the teacher to know their students and work.
It's always about experimenting.
It's most appropriate.
Yeah. So for example, I experimented the other day, with this, you know, because like delayed feedback sometimes didn't work so much, on the spot didn't work so much. So we somehow came up with this idea that I would just show them sort of like we agreed on a gesture. So it could have been this, could have been that, could, I don't know, whatever gesture. And when I showed the gesture, they could correct themselves, They didn't have to. So I gave them a chance. Hey, there's maybe something that you could improve. If they wanted to just get the message across, they went on. But if they wanted to correct themselves, and it, with some groups it worked. It was, at least it really was something that energized them, activated them. They were focusing more on, you know, the language at that moment. Yeah.
Very good. Okay. Right, now there's more questions coming in. I think we've actually covered all of these. Okay, there is one question about the term non-native speakers, which you have addressed in the webinar already, but it has come up as a question here saying, considering the global wide use of English, are the terms native speakers and non-native speakers still relevant?
Well, how much time do we have?
I know.
Oh my God.
So perhaps you can just think about your personal response to it. And, you know, it's a very big question, and it is something that's being discussed a lot.
Quite a few, like I know quite a few people who prefer different terms, saying I'm a
polyglot. Yeah.
You know, that has a more positive ring to it. At the same time, we all know that the word non-native speaker is in the discourse, is somehow being used. Me, my personal, and this is not something that is official in any way, but this is some, really like based on my own experience. I like redefining terms, you know, and I mentioned it the other day to you that here, the word teacher also sometimes didn't have such a great ring to it for some reason. And I really loved just the idea of being a good teacher, being a great teacher, you know, not giving a different name.
Yeah.
And I think it's, so here some people are called guides sometimes instead of being called teachers and stuff like that. And I think it's very, very similar with the word non-native. I honestly believe that it is also embracing and changing the whole discussion, moving it to different realms. But this is my personal opinion. And I understand why people might opt for using different terms.
And again, I suppose it's for the teaching community to sort of reflect and think about what they feel is appropriate for them. And
absolutely.
It's an ongoing discussion, isn't it, really? It's,
I mentioned it to you, Dunja.
It's a motive.
Absolutely. I mentioned it to you. I'm sorry, I'm having another thought looking at the comments here in the chat. I think also like native speakers are also non-native speakers. Like there is so, like most of us can speak a little bit a different second language. So we might, you know, we all are non-native speakers in one situation or the other. So I think it's quite cool to somehow embrace that and be proud of it. And
Proud
of it, that's the word, yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely. Thank you. And just to let you know, Huey, there's been lots of comments coming in from teachers saying, oh, I feel confident now about my accent and understanding how to answer
questions if
students are worried about having an accent. So that's really positive, isn't it?
Yeah.
And then I think the last question, this will be the last one to cover, we've had a question saying, I'm a native speaker. My students feel more embarrassed speaking with me in English than they do with my colleagues who may not be native speakers. How can I best remedy this? And you've touched on this already, haven't you, about showing your vulnerable side, perhaps attempting to speak their first language. Do you have any other tips at all?
And so now, how I understood the question was, I am a non-native speaker and they are... No,
I am a native speaker and the students feel embarrassed speaking to him, perhaps because he's native. They feel more comfortable speaking to colleagues who are non-native. So maybe they feel that they can understand them more.
Yeah. I think we've discussed this one, didn't we? So it's like really just to show your vulnerable side. Also, you can somehow show videos of native speakers making mistakes that sometimes they do, and so that could work. Interestingly enough, guys, I also got responses from my students saying I don't feel comfortable seeing learners who are like who have better English than me. You know, so they have the same first language. But there's this like negative downwards comparison. And so I think this discussion of these comparisons and just like putting it out there and discussing them together might somehow clear it out. And for them, it might really be a moment where they finally feel safe in
it. That's a really interesting point. And I can relate to that. When I was learning Spanish, if I was around friends or who spoke better Spanish than me, if we were out, I would just let them speak. They're better than me, I don't need to speak. but so sometimes it helps to be around others who might be struggling to build your confidence and have that understanding that it's okay.
Absolutely. Yeah it's just so vital to have like a safe environment, otherwise we can't grow.
Okay, well, I think we've covered the question, so thank you so much, and thank you to all our wonderful participants for joining us today and for being